Hi guys, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to each and everyone who have joined this session from across the globe. My name is Saurabh Charya. I'm a public speaking coach and author of a book called As Confidence Motion. I'm a certified NLP practitioner, a practicing motivation speaker, and I am from India. So in Indian style, namaste and welcome to each and every one of you. I was watching all of the speakers who spoke before me, and I must say they were all exceptional. A lot of value was being added in today's session. And I promise you, I'm going to add lots of value to each and every one of you in my next 15-20 minutes. So I was thinking, what should be the right topic to speak to network marketers? Because I'm not into network marketing myself, right? So I called my network marketing friend. He's Kalpesh. He's a distributor of King & Water. I asked him, Kalpesh brother, what should be the right topic to speak? Then he told me, Saurabh, network marketing. See the words. First, what is network, right? Now, to build a network of people, you need to communicate with them and communicate well with them, persuasively with them. Only then you can build network, right? And second word is marketing. To market a product or service properly, you should learn to communicate properly. That's when he told me, Saurabh, the best topic for network marketers would be communication, but not normal communication, persuasive communication, right? Which means convincing communication. So then I chose that topic, which is persuasive communication for my session. So that's the topic I have for you, which is persuasive communication or convincing communication. I'm going to share with you three simple strategies using which you can multiply your business. Okay, you can multiply your clients and become an effective communicator if you apply this right. Are you ready for this? So let's get started with the first step of persuasive communication, which I have for you. Now let me share my screen so that you can see as well. Instead of just listening to me, you can see the screen as well. Perfect. I hope you can see it now. Let me put in the slide mode. Perfect. The first persuasive tool which I have for you is widely known rhetoric called as ethos, pathos, and logos. I'm sure some of you heard of this and some of you wouldn't have heard of this, but I've seen very few people have depth of this. Okay. So I thought it's important to share this. No matter what kind of content is made in the world, if that content is persuasive, if that content is consuming, it will definitely follow ethos, pathos, logos formula. Now, who is the founder of this formula? Okay, the creator or the founder of this formula is Aristotle. Aristotle is called as father of philosophy. He's one of the pioneers in philosophy, right? Now, he made this formula long time ago, but it's still very much relevant. How we'll learn. Now, what is ethos, pathos, logos? Sounds weird for some of you. So let us understand what is ethos, pathos, and logos, right? Now, as you can see on your screen, ethos stands for credibility. Ethos for credibility, okay? Pathos stands for emotion. Logos stands for logic. And that's the sequence. Ethos, pathos, and logos. What it simply says is, when you talk to anyone, if you want to convince them with your talk, first try to build credibility with them. They should know you are the right person. They should trust you. You should sound credible. You should look credible. You or your company should look credible. Only then there's a trust happening, right? So that's the credibility. How to do it, we'll learn. Don't worry. Once that credibility is established, then you should emotionally connect with your customer, okay? By telling some stories, by scratching some pain which they are going through in their life. And then it makes logical sense to tell about the logic about your product or service. And then they will be willing to buy the product. Yeah. So ethos, pathos, then logos. That's the sequence. But many of us, we do a small mistake. What we do is we just start speaking logic. That's it. We keep speaking logic always in our speeches. We just talk about the features and benefits. That's the logic. But logic is not enough to convince people. They should trust you. They should connect with you. And only then they're willing to buy from you, right? Don't forget, we are emotional beings. I don't know you personally, but I know for sure that you're an emotional being. You have problems. You have relationship issues, money issues. And we feel loved, right? So we have those emotions in us and we are emotional beings. And you're going to sell to human beings, right? Emotional beings. So if they don't connect with you, if there's no bonding between you, they're not going to buy from you. So you have to learn to connect with people first, okay? That's where the pathos comes into picture. Now, I'll give some examples. Think of a movie you like. I'll take an example of my favorite movie, which is Avengers Endgame. In that movie, Avengers Endgame, you see the credibility of superheroes being used. You know, that's a movie where all your superheroes are there in one movie. Kids love it. I loved it. Right? A lot of credibility, a lot of ethos. And then the emotional aspect is the earth is at risk. Some people, bad people, are trying to destroy the earth. And superheroes are trying to save the earth. A lot of emotion. People are dying. People are struggling. A lot of fight is happening. So emotions are being conveyed there. And then they're using some logical mechanism to fight with them. They have some time machine. They have some weapons. So a lot of logic is also being displayed in the movie, isn't it? So ethos, pathos, logos in a movie. Now think of your favorite advertisement, right? I'll talk about my favorite advertisement being in India. It's a company called as Sensodyne. It's a toothpaste company, just like Colgate. In their advertisement, what they show is, they show a lady. That's how the ad starts, okay? They show a lady making a weird face, like, makes a weird face. She has some pain in her teeth, in her tooth, okay? Now that's intense pain. Now, because of the pain, sensitivity issue, she makes a weird face. And when you see that ad, okay, and even you have a sensitivity issue, what happens? You emotionally connect with that lady because, oh my God, I do the same when I feel that sensitivity, right? So there's an emotional connection happening with that lady. And then they show a doctor, a dentist, in fact, with a white coat, with a stethoscope. And then that doctor talks about how the sensitivity issues can be removed by using the toothpaste Sensodyne. And they use a word called as Indian Dental Association, which is the highest body for dental in India. So they're using credibility of Indian Dental Association plus credibility of a dentist to talk about the brand, which is Sensodyne. And finally, they show the Sensodyne toothpaste box that if you have sensitivity issues, if you have sensitive teeth, use this toothpaste. Wow, isn't it? How beautifully, persuasively they have used ethos, pathos, logos. Now think of BMW car, okay? It's an expensive car, costly car, few thousands of dollars you spend to buy that car. Now think of a Hyundai car, okay? Or a Kia car. You will get all the features which are present in BMW, okay? But still you're willing to spend thousands of dollars to buy that BMW car. Why? There's no logic or sense to spend that much of money apart from ethos and pathos. Because if you remove ethos, pathos, logically, if you see same features you're getting in a Hyundai car, why would you buy a BMW car? The reason is this, ethos and pathos. Why? See, credibility. BMW car has a credibility. That brand BMW has a credibility, right? Rich people own it. Now you want that credibility of BMW a little bit in your life, right? And when you have that car, you get that credibility of that car in your life as well, because people start respecting you more. People start seeing you as successful, and that's an emotional feeling you're craving for, right? Status symbol. You're craving for that status. You're loving that status, and that's pathos. And then it makes logical sense to spend that huge money to buy a BMW or a Mercedes Benz or whatever brand you like, the costly car. It makes sense to buy that car, not because of the features and benefits, because the credibility and the emotional connection you have owning that car. Is it making sense? So all our decisions are based on ethos, pathos, logos. Now, scientific evidence shows this as well, because this was told by Aristotle a long time ago, right? Now, scientific evidence is showing this. This is how the brain functions, okay? Now, let's see how this works in the scientific way, okay? As you can see here, the introduction to the brain, instinctive, emotional, and logical. That's how the decision-making process works. The first step is instinctive brain. Instinctive brain is nothing but it's a survival brain. All it wants to know is, am I safe here? Can I trust this person? If you feel that the person whom you're talking to is trustworthy, then you will go to second step is, do I care about what he or she is talking? Can I connect with the person? If you can trust the person, if you can connect with the person, then you care about, is he logically sounding right? Is he sounding right? Is he logical enough? And if the answer is still yes, then you go and make a decision, isn't it? So to make a decision, you need to qualify the instinctive brain, emotional brain, logical brain. And that's exactly ethos, pathos, logos. Yes? Ethos, can I trust you? That's what we understood, right? It's all about trust, credibility. Pathos, do I care about you? Which means emotionally, can I connect with you? And logos, do you sound right? Are you logical enough? So this is the reason why ethos, pathos, logos work, because that's how we make decisions. Now think of you buying something from Amazon.com. First, you would see the trust of the product by checking the reviews, isn't it? First, you check the reviews of the product. And only if you find the reviews are credible enough, then you go and check the reviews in detail. First, you check the ratings. Out of 5, what is the rating? Then you get a trust, it's above 4, right? Then you go and read some reviews. If you feel you are emotionally connecting with the reviews, then you will go and check the features and benefits of the product. Going to the specs, the details of the product, then you will buy the product if you qualify all these 3. So this is a basic decision-making process we go through. So this is what I want you to do even with your customers and clients. When you're talking to your customers, establish credibility with you or your brand. Then emotionally connect to them by telling a story, by telling the positive aspects which it brought in people's life, your product brought in people's life, and then give some logical reasons, some kind of researches, some kind of numbers, so that they trust it better. Okay, and that's about instinctive, emotional, logical pain. Now, I'll show some example of ethos, pathos, logos. As you can see here on your screen, this is example of ethos from a speech of Steve Jobs, 2005 Stanford speech. You see him using a lot of ethos. What is the meaning of ethos? Credibility, right? He's using a lot of credibility by talking about, he was working in a garage when he was 20. Then in 10 years, the Apple has grown to 4,000 employees. Then he's talking about his company called Next and Pixar. He's using a lot of his achievements to show his credibility. So that's about credibility. Talking about your achievements is credibility. That's ethos. Got it? Now, second is pathos. If you see, this is a speech, very famous speech, I Have a Dream by Martin Luther King, 1963. Pathos is emotional connection. You have to use a lot of emotional language. If you see here, Martin Luther King uses few words, okay? Like great trials and tribulations. Come fresh from narrow jail cells. Quest for freedom. Police brutality. Go back to Georgia. Go back to the slums. Okay. Now he is using a lot of emotions, or I would say empathetic language, to connect to the audience. And it was one of the finest speeches ever delivered on the earth. Okay. When it comes to emotions, Martin Luther King. That's about pathos. Using a lot of emotional language, feeling language. Now, logos, if you see, this is from Economic Outlook. You will see a lot of logics and numbers. For example, the United States has grown into the range of 1-2% annual rates. Then he talks about job security, prospects, a lot of logical, a lot of scientific words and language is being used to convey the logic or the logos part. Yeah. So that's the logos. So ethos, pathos, and logos. This is a beautiful formula you can use to convince anyone if you use it right. Now let's understand how to implement ethos, how to use ethos. Now ethos is about credibility, right? So talk about your authority on the subject. Now, as if you see my introduction, I said, so hi, this is Saurabh Charya. I'm a public speaking coach. I'm an author. I'm a certified NLP practitioner. So I talked about my credibility, my authority on the subject. You can use specialized terms or jargons about your industry. Okay. That makes people feel that, okay, this guy is expert in his field. And maybe you can use correct language or grammar or good arguments that conveys authority as well. Yeah. Now, example, my friend who has a PhD in nutritional science says that we should eat fewer carbohydrates. The credibility here is my friend who has a PhD in nutritional science. That's the credibility of your friend. And that's what you're using, right? So that's about ethos. That's how you can use ethos, by adding your authority, by using specialized term or jargons, or using correct language. Now, how to use pathos? You can use descriptive language or imagery. Now, what is the meaning of descriptive language? You can add details. You can make people visualize, use names, use colors, use date and time. Speak specifically, descriptive language, because that creates a visual way, visual impact in their head. And that's a beautiful way of speaking, by adding details. Second way to add pathos is by adding, or I would say identifying, emotional values which are relatable to your audience. Now, assuming you're talking to dog lovers, you can use something like, I know you love your dogs. So now you're telling, I know you love your dogs, because you know the value of them. They respect dogs. They value dogs. Okay. So use statements or words which evoke emotions in people. Is it making sense? Okay. For example, you're speaking to a group of vegans and you can tell, okay, I love being a vegan. I understand how being a vegan can change your life. When you say that, you're actually incongruent with their emotion and their values, and they love to listen to you, because that's where pathos is being used, right? The third one is you can use a story to create empathy. You can use stories. Stories sell if you really tell them well. So use stories. Use stories where you talk about some problem, some pain, and that product, which is your product, solve that pain for them. That's a beautiful story to tell, to connect to people's emotion. That's pathos. Example for pathos, as you can see here, if you don't purchase this life insurance and something happens to your family, how will they survive? This is how insurance is being sold across the world, isn't it? A lot of emotions are being displayed here. A lot of emotions are being displayed here, isn't it? About family surviving. How will they survive without you if you don't have this insurance? So that's about pathos. That's how you use pathos. Descriptive language, emotions and value, creating a story with a lot of empathy in it. How to use logos? Use research and statistics. Add numbers. Whenever there's a number, that's where it looks logical, right? You can use some logical process, like if this, then that. Okay. If you do this, then you achieve that. Something like that. Okay. Use logical process. Or you can give some solid evidence. You can talk about some researches, some facts, some stats, some evidence which is being conveyed, which is there in the open stream. You can just convey some evidence. Or you can say, you can talk about even the features of the product. So that's about logos. Example, a single cigarette contains over 4,800 chemicals. 69 of them are known to cause cancer. So why start smoking? If you see, number is being used here, 4,800 chemicals. 69 of them cause cancer. So using numbers, statistics to convey the logos part. Is it making sense? The key is in using it together. When you combine ethos with pathos and logos, that's when the real beauty happens. Okay. So use this. When you talk to your customers next time, first establish credibility with you and the product. Tell a story about the product which changed someone's life. Connect to their emotions, connect to their values, and then give some logic, some product and benefit features which can change their life. Then they will definitely love to buy from you. Yeah. So that's the first thing I want to share with you today. Now that's the first item. Let's discuss the second topic for today, is social proof, which is similarity in social proof. If you see, social proof itself is a very persuasive method of communicating with your audience, isn't it? If you see, when we make a decision about something, we always look for social proof. If you want to ask, if you want to check about a movie, you want to go for a movie, you will check the reviews in the internet about the movie. If you want to buy a product in Amazon, you will go and check the reviews of a product in Amazon. If you want to buy something from a store, you'll go and check the Google reviews. Okay. We do this. If you want to go and eat somewhere, you will check the reviews of that hotel, right? We do this naturally because what majority says is right for us. We want to do what majority is doing. That's social proof. But in that social proof, there's a very interesting combination of similarity in social proof. Now, what does this mean? This similarity in social proof simply means when you find a similar person like you, assuming there is a guy who is exactly like me from my own place, assuming he's also from India, he's from Hyderabad where I stay. He looks like me, he talks like me. If he does something, I would be persuaded much more effectively, much more better, rather than getting persuaded with someone random. Okay, now that's the example of similarity in social proof. If you can see this on your screen, you can see four Indians and a guy, normal people, okay, on a road, right? Now, these kind of people are shown a lot these days in TV advertisement. The reason is, as you can see here on the screen, advertisers now know that one successful way to sell a product to ordinary viewers is to demonstrate that other ordinary people like them use it. Which means if I am viewing the TV, if I see someone in the ad who looks like me, who feels like me, then I get naturally persuaded. Yeah, now that's the concept. Which simply means when you're talking to your customers, if you are giving them a testimonial or a review about your previous customers, don't give them review of someone who is elder than them or younger than them. Give them a review of a customer who is exactly like them, same gender, if possible, same age, if possible, speaking same language. If that happens, what happens is they start trusting the product much more than giving some random testimonial. Let me share a story about Joe. I read this from a book about similarity and social proof. Now, Joe is just 3 years old. His father was worried that he should learn swimming. Okay, Joe should learn swimming at just 3 years of age. And he started sending him to swimming classes. It was all fine and Joe was not scared of water though. But there's a problem with Joe was Joe never wanted to get in the water without the tube. He always wanted to get in the water just with the tube. That was okay for a few days, but later his father realized that it's not going to help him to learn swimming fast and better, right? It's a dependency on the tube. So he thought, let me push him to remove the tube and swim. But Joe was not listening. He was not willing at all. He tried so hard. His father tried so hard. Eventually, he gave up. Finally, he hired a swimming coach for Joe, okay? And that swimming coach was 21 years old. He was 6 feet tall. He was best swimmer he could ever get. And he started training Joe. The swimming coach started training Joe. But Joe was still not willing. He was still not ready to learn to swim without the tube. Finally, his father gave up. The swimming coach gave up. And it was one normal day. It was a summer camp which Joe was attending. His father left him in the morning. And evening, he came to pick him up. And in the evening, when his father arrived there, he saw Joe jumping into the pool. Now he got scared. He literally got scared. He removed his shoes and he was about to jump in the pool when he saw his son Joe diving deep in the pool and safely swimming and coming back again near the corner. Now when he saw, he was startled. He was like amazed to see his son swimming. Then he asked him, "Son, you can swim," with a lot of excitement. But this guy, Joe, was very normal. He said, "Well, I'm 3 years old and Tommy's 3 years old and Tommy can swim without the ring so that I can swim as well." When Joe said this to his father realized the mistake he was doing for the whole of his life to force Joe to learn swimming. Because what he forgot was, Joe was 3 years old and his swimming coach was 21 years old. When Joe saw his friend Tommy, who was exactly like him, who was exactly like him, 3 years old, if he can swim without a tube, even Tommy can swim without the tube. So he understood it, he accepted it, and then he started doing it. He was convinced because of Tommy, who was 3 years old, like Joe. Now that's a wow story for me, isn't it? Now what does this mean and what does this convey to you? It simply conveys to you that when you try to convince your customer, don't show them random testimonials. Try to show them exact testimonials of someone who is like them. Same gender, same age, same kind of problems. And they will be convinced faster. Yeah, very important thing to understand and use. That's my second thing. And third thing I really want to share with you today is the rule of three. And I'm going to end after this. The rule of three. It's a beautiful persuasive rule. Okay. As you can read here, the rule of three is based on the principle that things that come in three or are inherently funnier, more satisfying, or more effective than any other number. When used in words, either by speech or text, the reader or the audience is more likely to consume the information if it is written in threes. Threes are the right combination, ultimate combination to use to speak or write or deliver any kind of information. If you see my speech is again 3 points, right? That's what I shared with you. Even if you see ethos, pathos, logos, 3 words. So rule of three is very important, which means whenever you try to convince your customer, your clients, explain them the 3 basic points. Speak in the combination of threes because it looks more satisfying and more effective than any other number. It's easy to consume. I'll show you some examples, okay? How many traffic lights, like 3 lights? Can you see here 3 colors, right? Newton's laws are 3. In an atom, proton, neutron, electrons, 3. 3 basic colors, RGB, red, green, and blue. In an Olympics, how many medals? 3 medals. Yeah? Silver, bronze, and gold. Gandhiji from India, right? 3 monkeys of Gandhiji. If you see in a class, there are top 3 ranks. Yes? Now, rule of three is everywhere. Rule of three is a beautiful rule, used everywhere. Simple meaning of rule of three is whenever you're speaking, always speak in the combinations of three. With this, we finished today's session. I hope you enjoyed today's session. We have learned 3 important rules of persuasion. First one, ethos, pathos, logos. Second one, the social proof, similarity in social proof. And third one is the rule of three. Use this 3 and you will be able to persuade your audience, convince them and multiply your business and grow as a network marketer. Saurabh Charya here, ending this session. It was my pleasure to speak to you all. Thank you.